Thank you very much. And so let me thank first the organizers for the nice invitation. It's very nice to be here. And so, yes, my series of lecture will be about fundamental groups of complex algebraic varieties and how they interact with the geometry and the hyperbolicity properties of the underlying variety. Okay, and so I will start today with a lengthy introduction in some sense. And so the basic fact about this whole story is the following proposition. So let's fix x and y two, so connected. I guess I will forget every time to write it, but for me, if I don't tell it, everything is connected. So connected, compact. Complex manifolds. And assume that you are given also the holomorphic map. Which is a bimeromorphic. So then, each time you fix a point in X, you will get an induced map. On the fundamental groups, so we'll have S star going from the fundamental group of X at the point X to the fundamental group of Y at the image. Okay, so for me, it's really the topological fundamental group that I will look at. And so it's a homomorphism of group, but so the claim is that it's an isomorphism of group. Okay, and so I will prove it later in the course. But so in particular, this says that the fundamental group, the topological fundamental group, is a birational invariant of complex compact manifold. Okay. So in particular, pi 1 is an invariant of the birational classification of complex compact manifolds. So maybe here I should stress that in this proposition, both the compactness and the fact that it's smooth are important. Okay? You can try to find counterexample if you remove one of these assumptions. Okay, and so now the question I want to address is, so how this birational invariant, so how pi 1, does interact with the classical invariant of the birational classification. Like the Kodaira dimension. So let me recall briefly what it is. So don't remember about it. So you can define it for, let's say, any compact complex manifold. So in this situation, you can form the following graded ring, so the so-called canonical ring. Which is defined as follows. So on X, you have the canonical bundle, so the bundle of top differential forms. You can take it at the power k for any integer k. And I do the direct sum of this for any non-negative k. Okay, so it's a graded ring. You have it's a ring, okay, you can multiply. And it turns out that it's a birational invariant also of complex compact manifold. It's an exercise if you never saw it. And so what is the Codera dimension? It's a number associated to this ring, to say a bit how big it is. So by definition, so the Codera dimension of X, kappa of X is defined as follows. So when you have no pluridifferentials, so when this is the smaller possible, meaning when it's equal to C, we say that it's minus infinity. So if R of X is very small. And when it's not the case, you say that it's the transcendence degree over C of the fraction field of R. Okay, so it's one way to define it. There are many ways to define it. But so in particular, it gives you a number, which is either infinity or zero, one, and goes to the dimension of X. Okay, and so we say by definition that when the Codera dimension is maximal, so it's equal to dimension of X, we say that X is of general type. The idea being that if you are not of this general type, then there should be some geometric property of your variety explaining why you have less pluridifferentials. Okay? So let's come back to this question. So are there any link between the pi 1 and the Codera dimension? So first, let me just show you that there are no easy links. So maybe two remarks. So first, if you take any variety, so if X is a compact complex manifold, then of course, if you do the product of X with pi 1, you don't change the fundamental group. Okay, because it's a product of the fundamental group, and pi 1 is simply connected. But on the other hand, the Codera dimension of the product is always minus infinity. Okay, it's a fact, an exercise if you want. Any variety which is covered by pi 1s has no higher pluridifferentials. Okay, so if you begin with any variety, then you can construct another variety which has the same fundamental group, but a different Codera dimension a priori. Okay, so in particular, pi 1 does not determine the Codera dimension. So Now, another remark, which is in fact a result of Bogomolov, that I won't prove, but I can give you hints if you want. So which says the following. So you begin with X. Now, a smooth projective variety. Okay, so in particular, an algebraic one. And so the claim, the result of Bogomolov, is that there exists, so for any x, there exists y, another smooth projective variety, with the same fundamental group. But moreover, y is very, y has a numple cotangent bundle. Okay, so it's an algebraic properties, but these properties has many applications. So in particular, you can show that any variety with a numple cotangent bundle has no entire curves. Why? Has no entire curves. And something which is easier to prove is that Y, so the canonical bundle, omega of Y, is ample. So in particular, Y is of general type. Okay, so this says that if you begin with any smooth projective variety, then you will find another variety with the same fundamental group, but which is really hyperbolic in any sense you can think of. I mean, or at least conjecturally hyperbolic. So it is hyperbolic in the algebraical sense, in an analytical sense. I'm not claiming about the arithmetical sense, but conjecturally it should be. Okay, so a priori the question here is, the answer to the question is no, and I could have finished. But it turns out that there is still something to say, but it's more subtle, and this will be the. How do you? Yeah. So the idea is that. So it's in two steps. So let's do the first step. Assume, in particular, it says that. So of course there are smooth projective variety which are simply connected, like pi one. So this says that you can find simply connected variety with ample cotangent bundle. So to do this, you first need to find a projective surface with a big cotangent bundle, something a bit weaker, but this is something that you can control numerically, so using chain classes. So you do this. So let's take its S, my surface. So you first find S with a big omega 1 of S. And now what you do is you take S to some big power, and you will take a complete intersection inside of high codimension. So because of Lefschetz theorem that we will recall later, this is still simply connected. But now you can, in some sense, by going out the bad direction of this, you can make it ample. Okay? And then if you want to do the general case, you just take a product of X with this Sn and do the same kind of. Okay? This is the rough idea. Inside of, so this I will give more details later for the result. Yeah, it's because of so X will be a complete intersection. Okay, and there is a result of Lefschetz telling you that in the good situation, you don't change the fundamental group. Yeah, it's an isomorphism. Yes. Yeah, I began with SN simply connected. So in the general case, I do. Sorry. Yes. If you want, in the general case, I take SN times X, and I take a subvariety here. Yeah. But I can go back to this later with more tools. Okay, so but so the point that we will make later is that, however, so we will see that the fundamental group of, so let's say, to simplify, complex algebraic variety with a special, so we have to give a meaning to this, geometric properties, are very constrained. Okay, so now I would like to make a kind of tour to discuss what we know vaguely about fundamental groups. And so I will restrict to compact Keller manifold for some reason. Okay. Okay, so. Fundamental groups of compact Keller manifolds and birational classification. And so let me begin with what happened in dimension one. So we saw this more or less this morning. So I fix X a smooth proper curve of genus G. Okay, so G is either the half of the first Betti number, and it turned out to be equal to the dimension of the global differential forms. Okay, this is given by Hodge theory. And so we have a kind of trichotomy. So G equals zero. G equals one. And G at least two. Okay, so in this first case, we have only one example, by one. Here it's all the so-called, I mean, if you choose a point, it's an elliptic curve. And here, but you have many things. And so now let's look at the possible fundamental groups. So pi 1 is simply connected. Here, So an elliptic curve is of the form C by some lattice, where the lattice is isomorphic to Z2. And so in particular, the fundamental group is Z2. And here we have this quotiented by a discrete group of SL2 of R, SL2 of R. And so here we obtain gamma. And in fact, it depends only on G. Gamma G is, you have a presentation. So it is the free group in 2G element. What do I want? With one relation. The following relation. Okay, so in some sense, we have a presentation of this group and it depends only on the fundamental group. So now, what is the Codera dimension? For P1, we have no pluridifferential, so it's minus infinity. Here, you can check that for any case, there is only one. Okay, so if you want, the canonical bundle is trivial. So you check that k is equal to zero. And here, because of Riemann-Rohr, you can compute explicitly the number of pluridifferential. And if you do the computation, you should find something like this. But k has to be at least 2. Okay, so this is by Riemann-Rohr. So this, sorry, this is not the Codera dimension, this is the number of pluridifferential, so in particular. Yeah, sorry, it's not the way I defined it. But anyway, you can prove that the Codera dimension is 1. Okay, so in this example, we see something which is very special. So in particular, so the fundamental group here is abelian, and here it's non-abelian. So first remark, pi 1 is non-abelian if and only if k is 1. Okay, we'll say that the trivial group is abelian. So another thing is that in this situation, pi 1 determines the Codera dimension. Yeah, and also sorry?
Only because pi 1 is non-abelian for that dimension.
Yes, yeah, yeah. So all these remarks are for curves. Yeah, yeah. And the remark that I mean, all these remarks are true only for curves. So the situation is very special. So three, to say that pi 1 is trivial, if and only if we are in this situation. So one way to say it is this. And in this very special situation, it's equivalent to Codera dimension equal, no, I mean, this by definition is equal to this. Okay, so for curves, we have three kinds of geometry. So geometry with positive curvature, with zero curvature, and with a negative curvature. And this is reflected both in the Codera dimension and in the fundamental group. But this is very special for curves because, so what happened in higher dimension? So first something to keep in mind is that the pi 1 of, let's say, smooth, or even, of complex algebraic varieties are very mysterious. Okay, I will come back to this, but we know many properties they have, but for example, we know very few examples. It's very hard to construct a variety with a non-trivial fundamental group. But now, let's look to a special situation. So we have the so-called three pure geometries. So I will explain what I mean by this. So I want to generalize this trichotomy, but in higher dimension. And so one way to do this is the following. So I will look at the canonical bundle. And so the first situation is when the canonical bundle, or at least its inverse, is ample. Okay, and this is what people called Fano varieties. Okay, so I should say that my assumption here is that X is a compact Keller manifold. So this is the first class. A second class is when X, when the canonical bundle is trivial, or more generally, if some power of it is trivial. And the last class will be when the canonical bundle itself is ample. Okay, so these are some ways to generalize this trichotomy. So in this situation, the Kodaira dimension is minus infinity. I can write it. Here it will be zero, and here it will be dimension of X. Okay, so in particular, we don't get anything between zero and dimension X. It's very special. And so what are the fundamental group in this situation? So in this first, the fundamental group is trivial. Okay, so one way to prove it is because of one of Yao's theorem, you can put a metric with positive Ricci curvature on X. Then, because of this, there is a theorem of Myers. We tell you that any variety with a metric with a positive Ricci curvature has finite fundamental group. And then you know you need to go from finite to trivial, and there is some trick that I won't explain. Okay, but this is true. Now, what about this? So here, it's always virtually abelian. So by this, I mean that there is a finite index subgroup which is abelian. Okay, and because it's finitely generated, it's even there is a finite index subgroup which is really a free abelian of finite rank. Okay, and so what is the proof? I mean, the sketch of proof is that the same, you can put some nice metric on this, so a metric with zero Ricci curvature, so it's also a theorem of Yao. And then there is a so-called Bovill-Bogomolov decomposition, which tells you that in fact the variety in here are, there are three kind of variety, so complex, compact complex torus, tori, hyperkeller manifold, and Calabi-Yau variety. And if you look at each case, it's known that they are all virtually abelian. Okay, so. But now here it's, we don't know. And as I explained, because of Bogomolov results, everything can happen in some sense. I mean that every, if you take any smooth projective variety, then you will find a variety with omega x ample with the same fundamental group. Okay, this is the result of Bogomolov. But so now the minimal model program tells you in some sense that any variety should be built up from these pure geometries using some vibration and variational change. I mean, I'm very vague about this, but in some sense, yes, you should obtain everything from this. But the problem is that here we don't know much. Okay, so let me write this. So it's any smooth projective variety, but I could even say, any compact Keller manifold. Not much is known in this case, can be decomposed. By successive vibrations. Whose fibers are in each of the preceding class, and it's up to barational isomorphism, and it's also you need to take care of singularity, so it's a very rough statement. Plus, okay, so now let me give some results, some general results about fundamental groups, of the class of groups that can be obtained as fundamental group of smooth projective varieties. Okay, so by definition, a Keller group is an abstract group that can be obtained as the fundamental group a compact Keller manifold. And so inside the class of Keller groups, there is a subclass of projective group. It's maybe not a very good name, but these are the groups that are obtained as fundamental group of smooth projective variety. Okay, and the question is, what can we say about this class? So some results. So first, any Keller group is a finite presentation. Okay, so you can find finitely many generators, and the relations are also finitely generated. And so conversely, you can ask, is any group which is finitely presented a Keller group? So this is false. We'll explain why. But so there are some intermediate results. So conversely, any finitely presented group is the fundamental group of an irreducible complex projective variety. And this turned out to be difficult to prove this. And it's a result of Simpson. The difficulty being the irreducibility of the variety. Sorry? Not smooth. No. And not? Not normal. Yeah. Not normal. But not smooth. For sure, not smooth, because if it was a fundamental group of something which is smooth and projective, then in particular it would be something of compact Keller. Okay? Any smooth projective variety is a compact Keller manifold. And another result which goes in this direction, so is the fundamental group of something like this, and it's also the fundamental group of a compact real symplectic complex threefold. I will explain what I mean by this. And it's a result of Gompf. Okay, so it will be the fundamental group of a compact complex threefold such that the underlying real manifold has a symplectic form. And so I'm not claiming that the symplectic form is compatible with a complex structure, because it would say that it's a Keller manifold. So they both exist, but no compatibilities between them. Okay, so these two results say that any finitely presented group is very close to being the fundamental group of a compact Keller manifold, but it is not the fundamental group of the compact complex manifold. So one way to see it is the following. In fact, there are many known obstructions. So the easiest one is the following. So if you look, so let's take gamma, the Keller group. Then you can look at its first homology group, which is just the abelianization of gamma. And the claim is that, so this is a Z-module, it's an abelian group, and so of even rank. And why? It's just because if you look at its dual module, so which is just the cohomology of gamma. So let's say that it's pi 1 of x. So this is equal, because we are in rank 1, it's equal to h1 of the variety x with coefficient in z. And we know by Hodge theory that it has an even rank. Okay, B1 is always even for a compact Keller manifold. Sorry? Yes, I say that they are equal. No. You mean this or this? So here I mean the cohomology of gamma. And here, so the dual is this one, okay? This is a dual of this. But I claim that these are equal, in fact, when x, when gamma is a fundamental group of x. Okay, and this is not true in general, but it is true because we are looking in rank one. There is a spectral sequence which degenerate. And yeah, and now Hodge theory tells you about this group. Okay, it tells you that you have a decomposition of this group with coefficient in C. And in particular, it tells you that this group has even rank. So, yeah. So there are many more obstructions that I won't discuss because they are sophisticated. So many more. Obstruction. Okay, so maybe, so this says, for example, that Z, the group of integers, can never be the fundamental group of a compact Keller manifold. Okay. Okay, so okay, so now some examples. The first example is the following fact observed by Serre. So any finite group can be realized as the fundamental group of, in fact, a smooth projective variety. So it's due to Serre, and I guess I will give the proof later. Second class of example, if you take Z to the 2n, it is a fundamental group, in fact, of an abelian variety. Okay. Oh. But so, if now you look at Z2n plus what? 2n plus 1, it's not a Keller group because of this obstruction. So another simple example is all the gamma G, so the pi 1 of curves. So now a more sophisticated example. So take G to be semi-simple, real algebraic group, and assume that to G you can associate a symmetric space. So I would associated symmetric space. I will call it X. Is of non-compact type. So let me give some examples if you're not familiar with this. So the first example is G is SL2R. And X is a unit disk. So in higher dimension, you can take G to be SU1. SUN1, okay, so the group which fix a form of signature N1, and it acts on the ball, dimension N. And another example would be SP2GR acting on the Ziegle Hall space. And so, okay, so you have many more examples, but they are completely classified. And so what is the claim? What is what? The ball, the unit ball in CN. Yeah. And yeah. And so now the claim is that any co-compact torsion-free lattice. So discrete group so you take the real point of G and for simplicity I will take the connective component of the identity. It's not really important but it's to for the following to be really true. So any co-compact torsion free discrete group in G gamma, how did I write it? Yeah, for any. So if you look at the quotient of the symmetric space by gamma. So co-compact means exactly, so it's discrete. So you have an action on X, you can take the quotient. So X is a complex manifold.
X is
that space. Yeah, so you can think of the unit disk or the ball. You take the quotient, it gives you something which is because of the torsion freeness, you can verify that it's still a complex manifold. Co-compact means that this is compact. Okay, the quotient is compact. So this is a compact complex manifold, but so the claim is that in fact it has a unique algebraic structure. It's even a smooth projective variety. So it's a smooth projective variety. So it was first proved by Ziegler, but so with the technique of now modern techniques, it's quite easy to prove. And so of course. I mean, not of course, but X is simply connected. So in fact, and by one of this is gamma. Okay, so this gives a way to construct many algebraic varieties with interesting fundamental groups. And it's one of the only way. I mean, so it's transcendental. It's a transcendental construction, so it's quite flexible, but yeah. I mean, so of course there are other examples, but not many. It's hard. And I guess we will see some explanation of this fact later in the lectures. In some sense, any algebraic construction, doing only algebraic construction, you cannot obtain more difficult fundamental group. More, so you need really to use some transcendental techniques. Oh, this is the opposite. So Keller group means, so the claim is that any smooth projective variety is Keller. No, so it's a good question. It's a good question, it's unknown. So let me write this. So may just finish this and I comment on your question. So just some non-example. So the free group in N
generators,
so n at least one, is not Keller.
And
it's an exercise. It's an easy exercise.
A more sophisticated counterexample is the following. So you look at SLn of Z with n at least 2, and it's a fact that it's never Keller. And it's a deep result of Simpson, Carlos Simpson.
So now about your question. So the question is the following.
So can every Keller group be realized as the pi 1 of a smooth projective variety?
So in this generality, at the moment, it's unknown. But there are some interesting results in that direction. Okay, so first result is that, so this is true if you assume, moreover, gamma, if you assume that gamma is linear, meaning that it has a, you can embed it in some GLn of C for some n, then it's true, and it's so it's a result of Campana, Clodon, and Essidieu, later refined by Clodon. But on the other hand, it's known that all Keller groups do not satisfy this property.
However, not all Keller groups are not all so linear
meaning can be embedded in some GLn of C. And so the first example of Keller group, and in fact projective groups that are not linear, were given by Toledo in the 90s. And maybe this kind of question, so they are not all linear, but all known so all known examples of Keller groups, so in fact are projective groups for the moment. So all known examples of Keller group that are infinite, so of infinite Keller groups, admit representation, so a map to some GLn of C with infinite image. And it's a question to know if it's true in general. Can you detect that a Keller group is infinite just at looking at linear representation? Okay, I don't know if it's a conjecture or a question. I guess it's a question of Serre. Okay, and so now in the
remaining of time, I'd like to discuss, so maybe not give the proof, the complete proof that any finite group is a fundamental group of a smooth projective variety, but I will give you the main tool and leave it as an exercise. Okay, so it's a very important tool to compute fundamental group. So it's Lefschetz hyperplane theorem for the homotopy groups. And so the setting is as follows. You fix a smooth projective variety over the complex number, and I will say that it's of dimension n. And you take in psi of x, y, a numple effective divisor. So I'm not assuming that y is smooth. It's true. It just needs to be so an hypersurface, but it has to be ample. So now using the inclusion, you have a natural map. So I don't put a base point, but because they are all isomorphic. But so you have a natural map from the kth homotopy group of y inside the homotopy group of x. And so the claim is that it's an iso if k, what do I say? Yeah, k is less than n minus 1, and it's surjective if k is equal to n minus 1. Okay, so in particular, if you do k equals to 0, it gives you some connectivity result. And we are more interested in k equals 1. It says that if you are inside something of dimension at least 3, a numple hypersurface has the same fundamental group. And if you are in a surface, here it's clear. it's not clear. Numple hypersurface, its fundamental group is surject on the fundamental group of the surface. Okay, so yeah, maybe I just begin the proof and. And I'll let you finish. So we want to prove the following. Let G be a finite group. Then there exists X, a smooth projective variety, such that power one of X is isomorphic to G. So this is a statement. And in fact, so I say X is a smooth projective variety, but I could even take a smooth projective surface using this. Okay, so if I find a smooth projective variety which has a dimension strictly more than 2, then I cut it by a smooth ample hypersurface. Because of Lefschetz, it will have the same fundamental group. And I could go on and finishing with a smooth projective surface. Okay? And so what is the sketch of the proof? So the first step is to realize that it's sufficient to treat the case where G is a symmetric group in n variable. So why is it the case? So of course, any finite group is a subgroup of a symmetric group. And because everything is finite, it's a finite index subgroup. So if I can, if I have a solution, assume that X is a solution for the symmetric group, I claim that going to the corresponding étale, so if G is inside sigma of n, this corresponds to some étale cover of X. Okay, and if this one is smooth projective, an étale cover will be smooth projective and it will have the good fundamental group. Okay, so it's really sufficient to treat this. And so now what is the idea? The idea is to take any simply connected variety, so like Pn. Well, I will take Ps to the power n. And on this, I have a natural action of the symmetric group. Okay, switching now. So because this is simply connected, if the action would be free, we would be done. Okay, I can take this is my x, and I can take the quotient. Okay, so it's a quotient of a smooth projective variety by a finite group. We know that it exists as a normal projective variety. And if the action would be free, x would be the universal cover of that x is a quotient. But of course, the action is not free, because you have to. So if you look at, the place where two coordinates are equal is not free. And so the idea is to restrict to some variety on which it's free, and use the Lefschetz. So I don't give the details. If you're interested, I can give you the details. So I guess I will finish here. Thank you.